Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining. Am I doing this right? Is this live yet? Yes, it should be. Okay. Well, thank you for joining. Today, we'll be talking about Biton, and we will be using the analogy of an internet potluck to understand about how the internet could be. Okay. My name is Mario Isaakidis. And we've been doing this work in collaboration with the University of Waterloo and University College of London. It's a research project. I will try to keep the technical details out of, let's say, out of our way. So, this is the website that you can visit anytime. But in case you are wondering what the word potluck is, because I didn't know, I'm sure that there is something similar in your own culture. It is this type of gathering where people bring along something that they have cooked to share with other people. And I think it's a very good analogy because it is very close to the human nature of sharing and caring for others. You wouldn't bring along something that would poison your friends. Also, you have the opportunity to taste different cuisines, for example, different plates, and this it is something that is oriented towards sharing rather than consuming, in the sense of there is a central something authority that is preparing the food for you, and then you have to have a commercial relationship with them anyway. I hope, I understand it's about noontime in Canada, so I hope you're hungry because you're in for a treat. We will start with some aspirations about what Biton can be. And this is important because we are still working on the technology side, but at least we should have some common ground on what we're trying to build. And more specifically, we'll take a look at the trust model. Moving on to the main course, we will explain. We'll take a look at the Biton overlay and how we create, how we can scale a network over BitTorrent swarms. And we will also demonstrate the BitTorrent extension we have developed. And finally, we might talk a little bit about anonymity, given that we have the time for that. If you would like to ask any questions at any point, I understand that you can in the big blue button channel, and also there is the live stream, and please let me know if there are questions because I will have the slides on. Okay, so moving from the aspirations to the technical requirements, Biton aims to help people evade information controls. By information controls, we mean any control structure, any censorship and surveillance of our communications, any type of someone taking advantage of other people in our network communications. This was supposed to be more of like a discussion. I'm sorry about that. So the idea is that We have some technical mechanisms to do that. For example, you are familiar with networks like Tor and I2P and Freenet, that they mix traffic of users around, and we will be doing something similar with Biton. However, our approach is a little bit different. We believe that trust should start from end users and then propagate across their social links, their friends and the people that they trust. It is the case that, anyway, most of my sensitive communications have to do with people around me. So we need flexible trust models that account for social links, for social trust, and that they start from the end users and prioritize the local and move on towards the global. And we have seen that the internet that is built today around the hierarchical trust models that is introducing some issues, for example, where when there is a a large authority that gets compromised, for example, or that acts maliciously, that it has a larger effect in our communications. Furthermore, we want Biton to develop to work over our networks, over independent infrastructure, mesh topologies. What can I say about that? I don't have any notes actually, but in this way we can think of models where users actually own their data and their services. For that though, we also need to think about reputation mechanisms, key management. How do we provide the right incentives for people to contribute resources and to share their content? And with regards to the infrastructure, of course, we also need to be able to do that in ways that can scale and in ways that they can support the existing protocols, the legacy protocols, let's say, if we are moving to something new. And we also want to cross boundaries. May they be protocol boundaries in this case. It might be usability or localization. And for that, we also will talk a little bit about some mental models, some analogies that we can share applications that they are built on top of the Biton architecture. So Biton aims to be something like how do I explain that now? It will be like a network stack that takes care of your identity, takes care of addressing, and it will also will have built-in mechanisms for some anonymity. And it will work on top of on top of peer-to-peer networks, let's say. So we are building a scalable and anonymous overlay to interconnect peer-to-peer applications. The way we think about peer-to-peer applications today, and they are becoming more and more prominent, more and more successful. The way we think about peer-to-peer applications today is as independent, or the way we design them is as independent islands, which makes sense. I mean, you have some other nodes that they speak the same protocol, and they are specific to application, and they work fine. But this is not, I mean, this does not serve the purpose of anonymity very well, where you need to have as much variety and diversity in your communications, and also lots of traffic so that you can hide, for example, metadata about user activity. What we're trying to do is leverage the existing peer-to-peer connections with our friends and other trusted peers, and mix traffic around it across protocols, and in this way have in a way that it can scale so that we can have this Biton overlay. At first Biton is an addressing, it has an addressing scheme where users are reachable by their Biton address, and it also provides the scalable strategy for handling incoming requests. Which could be, for example, which allows you to spawn multiple nodes across the network and allow you to have more traffic coming to you without bottlenecks that could exist, for example, because of the network topology itself. All of the links are end-to-end encrypted, so the adversaries cannot eavesdrop on the peer-to-peer links. And if a message exits the network through a link that an adversary can observe, then we make it in this way such that the user can claim that, it can plausibly deny that it wasn't herself, for example, in this case, who was forwarding this message, but it was just passing along a message from another user. And we aim to also provide both routing and storage, and this has some interesting properties with regards to anonymity. First of all, because users can have a constant flow of traffic with storage replication that can serve as cover traffic, and the way we store files with redundancy allows users to insert something, then go offline, and they could still be available. So it's something similar to the freenet anonymous publishing model. So good so far? So far, so good. Did Biton originate as a fork of the waste or retroshare tools? I'm not familiar with it, but retroshare, from the little I know, is on top of BitTorrent, is based on this idea of friend of a friend connections. We have a different mixing strategy. And many other things are different now. It is a similar concept, though, very similar concept. The basic ingredients, now maybe this will make it more clear how Biton is different compared to RetroShare, for example. We provide the flexible social trust models, and they are available throughout the network stack. We support low latency routing, as in Tor, for example, which makes it a service-oriented network architecture. And we also provide redundant storage, which make it an information-centric network architecture. We have found a way to do efficient routing over a global overlay network that I will explain later on. And we are working on a mixing strategy in order to provide plausible deniability, meaning anonymity. And we want to also release Biton as something that developers can build up on other, for example, decentralized anonymous chat applications or marketplaces, or for example, they could use it for sharding blockchain networks. So it will be something like an infrastructure for our networks, if you would like. Let's start with how we create the address space of Biton. You can think of the way we create the addresses as a prism, where a user comes and they get assigned to a color. There are lots of colors in this case. From a technical point of view, this prism actually is a hash function that gets, for example, a key that a cryptographic key that a user has generated, and assigns here to a color. In this case, for example, it could be the yellow color. And if we go back to application-specific swarms in this case is clusters of nodes that they are connected around the service or some content. We can now use the Biton overlay to also cross the boundary of an application-specific swarm and connect with some users that are nearby in the Biton overlay space. So imagine that remember that we had the output of the prism before. We actually, if we go back and we see how the prism is arranged, if somebody was was assigned a red address and wanted to communicate with somebody who had a purple address, they would have to cross the whole spectrum. What we do is we join the spectrum edges. So somebody who is positioned in the red side of the on the right zone can communicate faster through a shorter path with a node in the purple side of the spectrum. And this is a very, typical technique for any addressing scheme. All distributed hash tables actually do that. Now, we can think of, for example, if this was a cabal swarm, we can think that the content that was specific to the cabal application remains local. And then we have does not leave the local swarm. And then we have mixing and storage replication across friends and across the global overlay. So it's somehow Biton is a larger umbrella that provides a global position for every node in the network. And in this way, we can think of three different trust models. First, the colors are wrong. Sorry about that. First is the commoners, for example, the connections in the Cabal swarm, Cabal being a decentralized peer-to-peer chat application over DAT, the DAT protocol. Then we could have, for example, friends. These are nodes who are not connected in the same application as you, who are not nearby in the Biton overlay space, but who users who you actually trust and you communicate with in your everyday life. In this case, for example, there is a light blue node that is not necessarily, it's not directly next to the yellow Biton address space, but we still make a trusted connection with them just because we will be sharing messages, we will be exchanging messages with them, and we trust them to pass along our requests to the network. And then we will also have some connections with strangers, with neighbors in the Biton overlay. If we go back, we can see that yellow is next to the green and the orange and red zone. So this is why we connect to these two nodes here. And as I mentioned before, it's pretty cool to have some shared mental models about how trust works for all applications, that for any application that might be developed on top of Biton. So we can think, for example, that we live in a white context, and then the user is in the center, and any information that is sensitive to the user, for example, a private key, can be depicted as a yellow, with a yellow color. Then a message, for example, or the identifier of a verified peer can be shown with a green color. And then any other node that we have not verified but is participating in the Biton network can be visually represented with the blue color. And then if something is gonna really degrade your security, it should be depicted with a color red, which is universally accepted and used as something that is dangerous. The idea here is that if, for example, you are in a chat room where you are with two friends that you have verified, and then somebody, and you are adding a node from a Biton node that you have not verified, it should be clear before the user make the action that this is going to degrade the security level to blue. And ideas like that, there are people who are working. I think it would be interesting for our network's participants to see. I think you've been working with that, and I think there are people who can do that much better. So I would like to hear your opinion about that. Maybe we can take a break, and I hope you are still hungry, because stay hungry, stay foolish. This is our sponsor, the Sahara message. Any questions so far? Okay. We have developed a demo of Biton over BitTorrent. We have actually implemented Biton as a BitTorrent extension, so that any client can that is speaking the BitTorrent protocol can add this plugin, let's say, and also support messages with Biton users. Why have we chosen BitTorrent though? First of all, because the connection model is very similar to what Biton needs. We have long-lived, encrypted, and high bandwidth connections. And very likely, all of the mechanisms that we need for exchanging files and sending messages, they are already built in BitTorrent. Saves us a lot of time, and it's a protocol that has been working. It has been tested, and moving to this point, it is very widely adopted, which means that if it would have been censored, then it would be very visible. It would create a high collateral, and people would be complaining. It has been used both by many of us for downloading torrents, but also by enterprises who are, for example, replicating parts of their data stores across continents. Also, BitTorrent, moving to the third point, sorry about that. It has built-in incentives for contributing resources, prioritizing rare files, etc., which are very useful for our case, for when it comes to the redundant storage we want to provide. It has a mechanism for decentralized peer discovery. This is the magnet links that instead of going through, for example, it does not encode any address of a central server that keeps track of who is participating in a BitTorrent swarm, who is sharing a torrent. Instead, there is a decentralized hash table, the mainline DHT, where nodes themselves announce announce themselves as participants in a swarm, and this information is not stored somewhere centrally, but all of the participants actually share part of this key value store. And finally, BitTorrent has, there is this phenomenon in BitTorrent and many other peer-to-peer networks of supernodes, nodes who contribute more resources. But BitTorrent has managed to actually use them in a very good way. And in the case of Biton, they can improve performance and they and the cast content availability. Now, how do we, but BitTorrent swarms, they're independent. How can we create a network that interconnects those BitTorrent swarms in a meaningful way? Any questions so far? So the BitTorrent encryption is not secure viable. This is, it's not, we have found ways to do that better, I would say. Specifically for the Biton protocol, we are using the noise library, and we are establishing an additional encryption layer on top of the BitTorrent encryption. Yet we need the BitTorrent layer, the BitTorrent link encryption, because we need to hide that we are exchanging Biton messages. Yes, Biton is supposed to run on end nodes, but we also want to account for super nodes that would probably be servers who can support more connections and have higher bandwidth, more resources. Yeah, oh, noise actually is pretty awesome. And for I will go through the implementation that we have, but everything is written in JavaScript. Yeah, actually, let's take a look at the demonstration now. Please do not join yet, because if you do, your IP address will appear on the screen and probably will be recorded. If you are okay with that, you can visit this link, demo.bitonproject.org. But again, I highlight that your IP address might appear in the video later on. So everything everything is written using web technologies in JavaScript, and we have implemented Biton as a WebTorrent extension, which is a BitTorrent implementation in JavaScript. So actually, your IP will not appear, but what you can see here is the public the Biton address of my node running locally on this browser tab. And this is somebody else who is running the Biton demo right now. Let me restart this, because I would like to show you some of the messages that show what's going on under the hood, let's say. In specific, we are using the Biton Zero version of the protocol, and for end-to-end encrypt communication, we are using this instantiation of noise. In particular, we are using the noisy library implementation in C that we have found compiled in WebAssembly, so we can also use that on the browser. And for Now, as we have started the demonstration, our browser has communicated with this decentralized peer discovery network of BitTorrent. And after they have generated an identity, which is a cryptographic key pair, they have found, oh yeah, actually your IP address will appear. I'm sorry about that. And you can see that we are exchanging some messages, some challenges to prove to the other person that we are actually know the secret of this Biton swarm. This is a function for private swarms, for a specific application, for example, so that no, even somebody will find out about your IP and about your swarm through the mainline DHT, they will not be able to make a connection with you. And then they will also exchange some other messages that actually are used for establishing the end-to-end encrypted connection. And finally, you can see that I have received a ping from one of the users here, and SP, so from this user, and we can send messages back to them, ping messages, and this will update the color of the respective circle in both browsers. And this could also run, for example, from your mobile phone or from any other web environment. It's implemented in Node.js, actually, so it can run as an application on your, as you would have expected, a BitTorrent client to work. Yeah, that's it pretty much with the demo. Yes, it is using WebTorrent. We are using the same notation here. The yellow is your node. This is your Biton ID. If you open a new window or if you refresh, then you will create a different key pair. So that is one. Mutability for torrents. We will, yes. So I mentioned before that we are planning to reuse the mechanisms of BitTorrent for exchanging, for example, what available files you have locally and what other people, what other files people need. But this mechanism works for fixed torrents. For example, for somebody uploads a movie and then the torrent commits to the files, to the file parts that respond only to this movie. So you cannot add something later on. We are planning to hijack this. Please. And thank you for sharing the repository. Wow, I'm excited. Thank you very much, guys. And this is the website, bitonproject.org.
I was just gonna jump in, sorry, and suggest if you want, you know, we can stop the stream if you want to move into more of a discussion, and then kind of continue demoing stuff and talking with folks, especially if folks want to like jump on camera and use their audio.
Oh yeah.
Okay, so maybe I'll just give a moment. If anyone who's not in the room wants to ask a final question, I'll check the live stream chat, and if there are no questions there, we'll stop the stream, and I would encourage people to do the emoji ASCII art silent shows of appreciation, because we don't all get to be in the room and give you a round of applause. And then we'll kind of move into discussion and kind of more informal space in the room. It'll still be open if people on the live stream want to join, chat want to join at that time. So one last second to see if there's questions popping up there. I'm not seeing any being typed, so let's say goodbye to the stream for now, and thank you to Marios, and then we'll stay in this room for the remainder of the session and people can chat here. And I'll do the twinkles again. So yeah, thank you so much.